something very rare in the woods. And it's somewhere. Oh my, the rarest of the rare. Polar black. Let's see if the tree can be my tripod. Let's see how this did. Okay.
How about that?
I forgot to bring paper in the woods, but you can see it writes.
It's even writing with gravity against it. This pen came in from the cold, and the reason for this odd demonstration of going out into the woods as if in search for a rare animal is that to produce this pen at the $55 retail price has been a challenge. I will not deny that to you. I tried, and everyone involved in this project tried very hard to get a decent number available before the holiday season. A fairly limited number has been available. This is the lowest number introduction availability of a Noodler's pen ever. The pens that are on the other side of the world in Singapore, I've been told that they already sold out. I don't know if the pens in the UK have sold out or if they're being held. It should be noted that the safety in the UK, there are 18 of them, and the imprint exists on the barrel. None of the other production has that, and in addition to that, there is an O-ring both in the rear of the pen as well as at the section to seal the nib feed unit. None of the others have that. It was determined that it's too difficult to remove that for artists who will be using inks that have stronger solvents, such as xylene and lacquer thinner. So that is a more or less an 18-issue prototype that exists in the UK. And speaking of the UK, some of you may have seen Jerusalem in the news. This ink was made and mixed for two cases on the very 100th year anniversary of General Allenby claiming Jerusalem from the Ottoman Turk. And there is one case for the United States and one case for the UK. And it simply says 100 years on it. And if you look at the anniversary day for when General Allenby took Jerusalem 100 years ago. In Massachusetts, it's very cold right now. Extremely cold. When you open a safety pin, always open it with the cap towards the ceiling. When you open it after it has been in extreme cold, have a paper towel handy. Because when you bring it into a warm room, after being at 11 degrees and overnight temperatures in single digits, it's going to expand any air that's in the chamber, and it's going to push the ink at great pressure against the seal within the cap. So a little tiny bit of ink, as you open it, will be pushed to the edge of the threads. So it's a good idea to have a paper towel handy. Then when you want to extend the safety pin, turn the base knob clockwise, firmly clockwise. This loosens the seal that's in the back of the barrel. The seal is meant to be a little stiff. The reason you want that seal to be a little stiff is because when you turn to right, sometimes you're going to flex. And as you're flexing, you're going to be pushing, likely holding it like this, not always having your forefinger touching the rear, holding the rear. The rear is purposefully made in an extended form so that you can grip it like this and keep it from coming back. Simply putting your thumb there keeps this, if you're really flexing it very hard and putting a great deal of pressure, from pushing it back into the chamber. But the seal was designed to be stiff enough so that if you like this for an extended period of time, it's never going to have a problem getting back into the chamber. The reason for that design, I fixed a lot of these years ago, and some repair people were using original cork, which already at that time was pushing 100 years of age, and it had deteriorated a bit and was fairly loose fitting. They might add some wax to it, but the mechanism would slide very easily. That cork, when it was originally made, was for a tight fit, and the wax was to hinder the movement of the rod, to make it a little rigid, a little stiff. So that, by design, this would have difficulty going back into the barrel. Simply because if you pull it back out with it like this, it would pour an ink puddle there. So, I want you to be aware of the basic dynamics of the design. Also, when you're about to cap it again, you want to... If you want it to last a very long time, you can pull it down gently and put the threads. There is a rod in there that will push the feed in so that you don't crush your nib and your feed. And I'll show you that when I disassemble the pen. Now, safety pens have always filled with an eyedropper. They're not self-filling. I've seen some pens that claim to be safety pens and they're self-filling. Or Parker claimed to have a jackknife safety because the inner cap would snap over the section. It's not a safety is a pen that when you fill it with ink and you screw the cap on, it literally corks the chamber. There are seals on both ends, and you can shake it around like crazy without having the nib and the feed bleed out all over the place. You open the cap, and then it drools out. Having a pen called a safety simply because it has a withdrawing mechanism and it still uses a cartridge is sort of an odd joke to me. Simply because they don't trust the public with an eyedropper-filled pen, that's what I believe. Oh, it'll make a mess. It's a fountain pen. One full squirt. One full squeeze. And then a partial squeeze. Or you could do a full squeeze. But you can see there's a bead of ink in there, and it's pretty high, so I purposely overfilled it. You can put this as deep as it will go and take the excess ink out of the top. Tap it a little so that the ink goes down to the base of the chamber. Sometimes there'll be an air pocket around the nib and the feed. Twist it clockwise and gently okay. That I got perfect. If it is overfilled, a good trick as you're drawing it up, if you have a bead of ink here, you just touch it to the glass and it will drain down back into the bottle. Or if you're not frugal, just have a paper towel handy and take the excess off. But it's ready to write. The cap does post tightly enough that it won't fall off. And because it bathes the nib in ink, every time it goes back into that chamber, it tends not to railroad. You can still push any fountain pen a lot and force it to if you're rapid enough in your writing movements or your drawing. But this one, because each time you shut it, you're covering that nib and that feed with ink. It's literally soaking in it all the time. It's going to be moist. And with a regular ink, like black or polar black, you don't have to be too worried about dryouts. Now, for the artists that are watching, with an India ink, or an ink with a bonding agent, or an ink that you've devised out of your artist supplies. With a bonding agent, or with shellac in it, something like that, it will keep the nib and the feed moist, and you can give it a shake to make sure that everything is aqueous. However, if you leave it like this and forget about it for 2 hours, you can expect something to dry there. So be aware that as you're leaving it out, that material is drying on the nib. So if you're using a bonding ink, it is similar to other fountain pens in that the nib is subject to evaporation. What's different about the safety is the magic of after, say, 2 or 3 minutes before the drying effects get too aggressive, you can draw it back in, and it's sealed up just like a bottle. And everything's covered in ink again. This is the first time I've had this happen, and I'm just going to apologize to everyone about it. The industry that makes the raw materials, which are used to make ink, is in a little bit of turmoil. And the raw materials for these particular inks have not really come through, and this is the first time that an ink was introduced. These were introduced at the Boston show, where the supply of the ink is actually less than the supply of the pens, and this pen happens to be the lowest in supply and number of any introduction of any Noodler's pen we've ever done. The only reason I'm even showing them is that I have a reasonable expectation that these will become readily available in the future. I don't know how far out in the future that will be. To show you how difficult it's been, this particular ink is called Boston Massacre. It wasn't even available at the Boston show. I had the label all done up, but it wasn't. It wasn't available for sale there. These are still the same from the Boston show, and you can see the nice shine. Bunker Hill Blue, Harbor Tea, Patriot Gunpowder, 1776 Green, spelled with an E at the end, and Boston Massacre. Sooner or later, they have unique properties. If you run an alcohol-based highlighter or an alcohol-based ink across the line after it's been dried on the document you've written or the drawing, it won't smear. It resists a lot that somebody using watercolors, somebody using paints, and happened to use a pen to outline a drawing, and yet they are water-based, which it's not a shellac alcohol containing India ink. It's different from the other inks. It's new, but the turmoil in the industry has caused a few hiccups. They will be available, but it's going to take some time. And hopefully they'll be available in some reasonable quantities. I can't promise that they'll ever be available in large quantities. The disassembly and reassembly of the safety pen. If you ever want to clean the cap, run a paper towel through it, or a Q-tip, it's threaded, and it's easy to unscrew. And you can clean up any excess ink that's built up in there. Or use a pipe cleaner brush in case you forgot about it and you let it dry out. This is the only real instance of going counterclockwise. The reason I was stressing, when you want to extend the nib in the feed, you always give it a little twist clockwise and then move forward, is because every bit of this pen, including the internals, are all threaded to be disassembled by going counterclockwise. Threaded on the inside and the outside. Note again, these are the only tools you need for the entire process. If you find that you are switching out O-rings frequently for some unknown reason, I would highly suggest that if you don't have a leaking seal, leave it alone. The O-ring is a little difficult to get out. But if you have to get it out frequently, you're an artist and you're using inks that are lacquer-based, have xylene, have those nasty solvents that will dissolve an O-ring, and you have to replace it with something else, I would suggest a little bit of silicone grease on these threads, because it makes it easier to remove the O-ring from the unit if there's a little silicone grease on the wall. Normally there isn't. Most silicone grease, it's applied on the rod, and it's only the rod that has to slide, and you definitely don't want any silicone grease to get on your feed or your nib. It will hinder the flow of water-based inks and cause the pen not to function well, and you'll have to scrub that off, assuming you can see it. You can smear a little bit of silicone grease on the inside of a nib and actually make it fail to function at all. So be very careful with silicone grease when you're... Just don't get it on ebonite or the feed, the ebonite feed. I like to put this back on and then grip it like this and use it to pull, and it pulls the O-ring out. The initial production, this is green ebonite, this piece. The very first few actually have this. In fact, I guess in years hence, you'll be able to tell early production because of this green ebonite piece. And again, not that you will ever need to do this, but this piece also unscrews counterclockwise and is threaded. That's in case you find yourself, and it should be put fairly tight together because you want that to resist that. That's in case you've been unscrewing the pen counterclockwise when it's been fully extended, or somebody who doesn't know about your safety does it, and the pen is up here, and they're unscrewing it counterclockwise, and this joint happens to be tighter than that joint, and it separates. Don't panic. It just means they've disassembled the pen on the inside. Reassembly. Just put the O-rings there and gently push a little bit of silicone grease on the outside. Will help slide it in over the threads and seat it. And now you've got a nice tight seal to prevent any ink from getting out. You look for the threads. The other side is smooth. Clockwise turn. And of course, once the O-rings are loose and you've moved them after they've been stationary for a while, you can literally just pop it out back and forth. Here, you might want to put a little bit of silicone grease in the threads You don't want it to get in around the nib, but a little bit in the threads to prevent any of the ink from creeping up and reaching your shirt pocket. And you'll find that they already have that, but assuming this video stays up for a long time, and perhaps it's 30 years hence, voila. And to prove, let's see, when this eventually becomes readily available, which at the moment it is not, these are still, I'm doing my best, and I believe they will become readily available. It's just a matter of time. They have to have the right properties. They have to resist the right solvents that artists use that are compatible with an ebonite safety pen. These definitely have to be shaken vigorously. They also have to be shaken when they're in the pen. Treat it like an India ink. It's also a good idea to, if you get excess here, to wipe that off before you shut it again, because it will get sticky. Same as with conventional inks, one good squeeze of the eyedropper and then a partial squeeze of that. I would say let 3/4 go in and you won't have to do much of anything. There's an MIT professor who snagged a couple of these after the Boston show, and he would tap it to break the meniscus and get it to flow back into the pen. Now there's a little excess ink there. This is what I like to do. Just let it go down the glass. Way that you don't waste any. Okay, it's just gotten a little bit tacky there. Let's see if I can show them. There are two little dots on the nib face there. Now there's a slight time lapse to get it to dry. Firm, so that it's nice and sealed. Now let's see if they rub off. Yeah, they were aqueous again. So if you get it to dry, the magic of a safety pen is that you're able to get the nib and the feed completely covered in the bonding ink again, and to re-liquefy. But you have to be aware that you have a set amount of time. As you use an ink like that, you'll likely know when it's about to dry out. But the safety pen does enable you to have the potential, if you have discipline and you know what you're doing, to use India inks, bonding inks, and the like. But be aware, they are drying on that nib every moment you have it exposed. So there should be care in the timing of your work. Okay, this is 91% isopropyl alcohol. Finally got some. Didn't let it dry enough. But you can see the vast majority that did dry, did not do that. This particular formulation, it's water-based. So if it's mistakenly put in an AHAB, just quickly rinse it out with water. Don't let it dry. If it dries, there's only one thing that I've found that can remove it readily. But that's the idea. An artist wants a bonded ink, an India ink, to serve as an outline, frequently under many other types of media. They want it to resist many other types of solvents once it's dry. And you do have to let it dry. If it's not dry, even water can remove it. But when it's dry, it becomes extremely durable. And that's the whole point of the engineering of this ink. If you fill that pen and you leave it open, and it dries over a whole vacation period or weekend, and it's in a hot, dry room, the way you can clean it, the only way I have found to clean it, is to use an orange citrus-based solvent cleaner, such as Goof Off or Goo Off. They're readily available at your hardware store, and a toothbrush. And you just scrub it off with that. And that removes it from the pen. Oddly enough, there are some paper grades I was not able to remove it with an orange-based cleaner. It would simply destroy the paper. So it's an extraordinarily durable ink. And if you make your outline with it, I've tried my best to make sure that your outline is going to stay there. Regardless of what kind of paints you put over it. Done the absolute best. If you find something that obliterates it on the page, please contact Luxury Brands. Tell them, let them know. We won't be reaching that stage for a while, simply because this is not going to be commonly available on the market. Right now they're about 20 bottles each. That's how low this is, but in time, I'm hoping that it becomes more readily available And I wouldn't be talking about it if I didn't have confidence that we would eventually have some readily available in the marketplace. Lastly, I'm simply going to reassemble some of these safety pins just to demonstrate how it's done. Again, these O-rings can be found in the plumbing section of your hardware store, just like most Noodler's O-rings can be found there. And unless abused a lot or torn heavily, they'll last a long time. Put the retaining ring. Just gently push the O-rings in, engage the threads. It'll get a little tight. A little bit of silicone grease there. Always clockwise at this stage, so as not to disassemble anything. Clockwise. Clockwise. One last mention, the few that made it to the UK, these imprints, in the UK the imprint is here, and in the UK there is an O-ring seal in the front. So fair warning, if you get one of those 18 pens, they're prototypes. They're very unique. They're different from any other Noodler's pens that'll be made after. And I highly recommend you don't try to use xylene-based solvents, lacquer thinner-based solvents, anything that necessitates the removal of the O-ring. Because the O-ring will be very difficult to remove in that UK model. All ensuing UK production will be just like the American. Simply that early prototype was all that was available to get some safety pens to the UK in time for the holiday season. I would have, of course, liked to have larger quantities. The fact that the quantity in Singapore vanished, apparently in minutes. I had hoped it would last longer. This was the earlier sample of Boston Massacre, where you can see those colors. Harbor Tea, Bunker Hill Blue, Patriot Gunpowder, 1776 Green, and Boston Massacre. You can see the shine on it. It is very much a bonded ink. That's a sum total. I hope it was at least partially entertaining for you.